for that was that the Greek election were announced a couple of weeks ago, so we didn't have enough time because we didn't know. So on behalf of ReINFORM, I would like to welcome you here and thank you very much for coming. So what is this event about? It is about the Greek elections. And it appears the Greek election is not just a national issue, it's not just a Greek issue anymore, because it's a matter of interest of many European, let's say, media. They're talking about the elections, about the outcome of the election, of what the outcome of the election would mean for the economic crisis and for the euro, for the European situation. And some of them describe a rather lack outcome, like an economic catastrophe in case of a change in the government, in the Greek government. Is that so? That's the question I'd like to answer here, I'd like to discuss. What is threatening? What is the threat? And what are the challenges? So we have here nice panel. We have Nikoletta from ReINFORM. She's going to give us an introductory speech. We have Hans van Heijnigen, the General Secretary of the ESPE, who's going to talk about the ESPE position on the Greek elections and the Greek situation. Thank you very much for being with us. And we have Sol Trumbo, who's a member of the Circle of Podemos in Amsterdam and a researcher in the Transnational Institute. And he's going to talk about the meaning of Greek election for movement in Spain and in Europe in general. Before I give the microphone to Nikoletta, I would like to remind you, we have a box outside for your contributions. It's just to cover the expenses for this event, so please, whatever your contribution you want to be, don't forget our box. Thank you very much. So Nikoletta is going to give the introductory speech. And after all speeches, so we're going to have a discussion. Nikoletta is going to speak in Greek, and I'm going to translate for her.
Το θέμα που θα αναπτύξω είναι ποιος φοβάται αλήθεια τις ελληνικές εκλογές. Ποιος ανησυχεί, είναι ο ελληνικός λαός, όχι δεν πιστεύουμε ότι είναι αυτός. Είναι ο ολλανδικός λαός, ούτε αυτός. Πιστεύουμε ότι αυτοί που αλήθεια ανησυχούν είναι η ελληνική και ευρωπαϊκή ελίτ, η οποία θα χάσει τα προνόμια της.
So the topic here, who is afraid of the Greek election, that's a big question. Is it the Greek people? Is it European people? No, we don't think so. It's neither the Greek nor the European people that is afraid of the election. It's rather the Greek and European elite who is afraid of losing their privileges.
Αρχηγοί και οι Έλληνες αρχηγοί, με το που προκριθήκαν οι ελληνικές εκλογές, προσπαθήσανε να μας πείσουν ότι εάν οι Έλληνες ψηφίσουν κάτι άλλο από τους υπάρχοντες αρχηγούς, θα έρθει η καταστροφή. Η καταστροφή της Ελλάδας και η καταστροφή της Ευρώπης. Λοιπόν, θα πρέπει να ψηφίσουν υπεύθυνα.
So, once Greek elections were announced, Greek and European leaders tried to make and convince the Greek population and Greek citizens that they will have to think very responsibly for the next government they're going to elect, because if they don't, if they change the current government, the current status, it's going to be a big catastrophe. So they have to be very responsible here.
Ας ξεκινήσουμε με το τι είναι η ελληνική κρίση. Εδώ στην Ολλανδία και στην Ευρώπη προσπάθησαν να μας πείσουν στην αρχή ότι η ελληνική κρίση είναι αποτέλεσμα μερικών διεφθαρμένων πολιτικών και κυρίως αποτέλεσμα του ελληνικού λαού που είναι τεμπέλης και αντιπαραγωγικός.
So, first things first, let's talk about the Greek crisis. the story. What was the story about it? They tried to convince us that Greek crisis was a matter of some corrupted politicians, Greek politicians, as well as some, as you know, the lazy Greeks that do not work, that they don't pay taxes, and they're counterproductive.
Εν τω μεταξύ ξέρουμε ότι η ευρωπαϊκή κρίση, ότι η ελληνική κρίση είναι ευρωπαϊκή κρίση και παγκόσμια, η κρίση του καπιταλισμού και αυτοί που τη δημιούργησαν ήταν οι τράπεζες και τα χρηματοπιστωτικά ιδρύματα τα οποία βασικά κερδοφόρησαν σε βάρος των κρατών και των λαών.
On the other hand, what we do know now is that the Greek crisis is not Greek, it's rather a European and an international crisis. And it's a crisis of the current system, of the capitalist system. And it is the result of the financial institutions and banks that speculated against people with money from people and from the states.
Η ελληνική οικονομία ήταν πάντοτε μια αδύνατη οικονομία από τότε που δημιουργήθηκε το ελληνικό κράτος και οι Έλληνες πολιτικοί ήταν σχεδόν πάντα διεφθαρμένοι. Οι διεφθαρμένοι Έλληνες πολιτικοί ήταν αυτοί που για να βάλουν την Ελλάδα στο ευρώ μαγείρεψαν τα στοιχεία και αυτό δεν το κάνανε μόνοι τους, το κάνανε με το μεγαλύτερο χρηματοπιστωτικό ίδρυμα του κόσμου, την Goldman Sachs. Η Goldman Sachs μαγείρεψε τα στοιχεία και μετά κερδοφόρησε απίστευτα από την ελληνική κρίση.
We know that the Greek economy has been, from the foundation of the Greek state, a very weak and poor economy. And we do know that the Greek politicians were very much corrupted. And we do know that they have cooked the figures so that Greece enters the Eurozone, for example. However, we also know that the biggest finance institution, Goldman Sachs, had played a role there. It was them with the corrupted politicians that cooked the figures together. And after that, they had speculated against people's money, and they have earned a lot. They made a lot of profit through the crisis, the Greek economic crisis.
Η απάντηση, η λύση που μας πρότεινε, που μας επέβαλε η Τρόικα, ήταν από τις πιο βαριές νεοφιλελεύθερα προγράμματα που εφαρμόστηκαν ποτέ στην Ευρώπη. Η λύση αυτή ήταν μια πραγματική γιορτή για το κεφάλαιο με πώληση, σχεδόν χάρισμα του δημόσιου πλούτου, με σχεδόν κατάργηση των εργατικών δικαιωμάτων και του ελάχιστου μισθού.
So the solution imposed by Troika, the European Union, that is the European Union, the ECB and the IMF, was the toughest new liberal program ever imposed in an EU country. It has been a feast for the elites and the capital. And it constituted taxes, like big taxes in the private ownership, of giving out, or rather sold in very, very low prices, of state property and abolishment of labor rights.
Σε αυτή την καταστροφή υπήρχαν και αυτοί που κέρδισαν. Και ξέρουμε τώρα ότι η οικονομική ψαλίδα ανάμεσα στους φτωχότερους και στους πλουσιότερους αυξήθηκε με τεράστιους ρυθμούς από το 2009 και το 2010, από τότε που δημιουργήθηκε η κρίση.
Through this crisis, there have been also winners, as you can see in the graph, since 2009. The difference between poor and rich became bigger and bigger.
Δυστυχώς, ο μεγάλος χαμένος ήταν ο ελληνικός λαός, με 3 εκατομμύρια κόσμο χωρίς υγεία, με τεράστια αύξηση της ανεργίας και με διπλασιασμό των απόπειρων αυτοκτονίας και με μίνιμουμ μισθό γύρω στα 586 ευρώ με τιμές που σχεδόν αγγίζουν τις ελλαδικές τιμές.
Unfortunately, the losers were the people in Greece, with 3 million people having no access to public care, with unemployment rates close to 26.7%, suicide rates doubled, and minimum salary of 586 euro in a country where the living cost is very similar to the living cost here in the Netherlands.
Μέσα σε όλη αυτή την κατάσταση, ένα τεράστιο κύμα διαμαρτυρίας ξεσηκώθηκε στην Ελλάδα. Ο λαός βγήκε στους δρόμους, διαμαρτυρήθηκε και μέσα από αυτές τις διαμαρτυρίες διαμορφώθηκαν και τα λαϊκά αιτήματα.
As a result of the situation, we had a mass movement from the people. People protested, they went into the streets, and through this protest, there have been created some clear demands.
Το βασικό αίτημα το οποίο υπήρξε ήταν δεν πληρώνω την κρίση τους, να πληρώσουν την κρίση αυτή που τη δημιούργησαν.
One of the main demands were, I'm not going to pay for this crisis. This crisis has to be paid by those that created it.
Άλλο αίτημα ήταν η αποκατάσταση της δημοκρατίας, γιατί με την Τρόικα ουσιαστικά η Ελλάδα βρέθηκε κάτω από κατοχή.
Another demand was the restoration of democracy, because with Troika giving directions to the government, the Greek government was under occupation, let's say, from the Troika.
Και ένα επίσης βασικό αίτημα ήταν η τιμωρία των διεφθαρμένων πολιτικών που μας έφεραν σε αυτή την κατάσταση. Πάνω δεξιά έχω βάλει αυτή τη φωτογραφία που είναι οι κρεμάλες στο Σύνταγμα και αυτό δείχνει το πόσο ο ελληνικός λαός ήταν εχθρικός απέναντι σε αυτή την κυβέρνηση και απέναντι στην τιμωρία τους. Πολύ συχνά εδώ στην Ολλανδία είπαν ότι ο ελληνικός λαός έχει πρόβλημα με την Ευρώπη και δεν κάνει τίποτα για τους δικούς του ηγέτες. Θέλω να πω ότι οι Έλληνες πολιτικοί, τουλάχιστον στην αρχή της κρίσης, δεν τολμούσαν ούτε να βγουν από το σπίτι τους και να εμφανιστούν, γιατί ο λαός ήταν εναντίον τους και τους πετάγανε για όρτια.
Yes. So another demand was the punishment of those that are really responsible for the situation. And people were had the Greek politicians in mind. So in the picture, in the right corner, you can see the gallows in front of the parliament. That's a symbol of this demand. Here in the Netherlands, we hear sometimes that Greeks only accuse the Europeans for the crisis, for the situation. That's not really accurate. Greeks were furious against Greek politicians, and in the beginning of this crisis, Greek politicians would not dare to go out to walk alone because they had to face the frustration of people that would attack them with yogurt and with things like that.
Η απάντηση της ελληνικής κυβέρνησης στα αιτήματα του λαού ήταν αυτή που βλέπετε. Δεν υπάρχουν λόγια. Το πρόγραμμα της Τρόικας δεν θα μπορούσε ποτέ να σταθεί χωρίς την απίστευτη καταστολή και τρομοκρατία η οποία επιβλήθηκε τα τελευταία χρόνια στην Ελλάδα.
The response to these demands by the government was this, the picture you see. There are no words describing the the repression and the violence of the Greek state against the protesters. Those austerity measures would have never been imposed unless the demands and the protesters wouldn't be so brutally repressed.
Οι ηγέτες της Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης το θεώρησαν αναγκαίο κακό και ουδέποτε είπαν κάτι ενάντια στην καταπάτηση των ανθρωπίνων δικαιωμάτων που έχει γίνει στην Ελλάδα.
European leaders respond, well, their reaction to that was nothing. They thought that was the necessary evil of the situation, and they never said a word condemning this violation of human rights that happened in Greece.
Μέσα σε όλη αυτή την κατάσταση, ο ΣΥΡΙΖΑ δυνάμωσε ακόμα περισσότερο. Και ο ΣΥΡΙΖΑ, επειδή ακριβώς πήρε μέρος της κινητοποίησης, υιοθέτησε και μεγάλο αριθμό από τα αιτήματα, από τα λαϊκά αιτήματα.
So through this situation, ΣΥΡΙΖΑ went bigger, stronger. It took part in the movements, and that's why it also adopted the basic demands of the movement.
Αυτό που θέλω να τονίσω είναι ότι ο ΣΥΡΙΖΑ δεν είναι ένα κόμμα το οποίο βγήκε από πολιτικούς, από μια οικογένεια πολιτικών που αποφάσισαν να φτιάξουν ένα καινούριο κόμμα, αλλά γεννήθηκε μέσα από τον ακτιβισμό.
What we have to say about ΣΥΡΙΖΑ is that it's not a party created by a politician family, as it's the case with many big parties in Greece. It's a party that was created by activists.
Το εκλογικό πρόγραμμα του ΣΥΡΙΖΑ είναι ένα ήπιο εκλογικό πρόγραμμα που υιοθέτησε ένα μόνο κομμάτι από τα λαϊκά αιτήματα και όχι όλα. Για παράδειγμα, αντί για διαγραφή, για μονομερή διαγραφή του χρέους, πιστεύει ότι πρέπει να γίνει διαπραγμάτευση, επαναδιαπραγμάτευση του χρέους.
So the election, the program of Syriza for this election, it's a little bit more moderate than initially. So it doesn't talk anymore about abolishing the debt. It rather talks about the renegotiation of the debt.
Αποτελείται από δύο πυλώνες. Το ένα είναι επαναδιαπραγμάτευση του χρέους και από το άλλο είναι ένα πρόγραμμα επανόρθωσης της οικονομίας με βοήθεια των λαϊκών στρωμάτων και της ανεργίας.
So the program consists of two pillars. One pillar is the renegotiation of the debt. The other pillar has to do with national reforms, economic reforms, helping mostly the lower class.
Στο πρόγραμμα του ΣΥΡΙΖΑ υπάρχει και κριτική από τα αριστερά. Ένα κομμάτι της κριτικής έχει να κάνει με το οικονομικό πρόγραμμα, το πού θα βρεθούν τα χρήματα για την επανόρθωση, για το πρόγραμμα επανόρθωσης. Και κυρίως η μεγαλύτερη κριτική αφορά το κατά πόσο είναι δυνατόν αλλαγές μέσα στο ευρώ και στην Ευρώπη.
There has been critics on the Syriza program from the leftists. Program has been criticized of having been conservative, of having insufficient economic vision, and the biggest criticism is on how can such reforms be realized within EU and the Eurozone.
Και αυτό είναι ένα σοβαρό θέμα και μια σοβαρή συζήτηση που ελπίζω θα συνεχιστεί μετά εδώ κατά τη διάρκεια της συζήτησης που έχουμε.
So this is a very big and important issue that we hope to discuss this today as well.
παρακαλώ. Εδώ έχω ένα διάλογο το οποίο πιστεύω ότι είναι αρκετά ανεξάρτητο και το οποίο δείχνει τι πιστεύουν αλήθεια οι Έλληνες. 52% νιώθουν λιγότερο Ευρωπαίοι και θα προτιμούσαν το δικό τους εθνικό νόμισμα.
So this is an opinion poll, which we believe is independent enough. It shows that 52% of Greeks feel less European, and they would also prefer their own national currency.
Αυτό δείχνει ότι ο ελληνικός λαός και η άποψή του δεν μπορεί να μπει σε κουτάκια που θα θέλανε οι ηγέτες της Ευρωπαϊκής Ένωσης και η ελίτ της Ελλάδας.
So that shows that Greek people do not fit into the box the European leaders wants people to fit in.
Και δείχνει κατά τη γνώμη μου τι είναι αυτό που φοβάται τελικά η ευρωπαϊκή και η ελληνική ελίτ.
And finally, this is what the European and Greek elite is afraid of.
Πιστεύω ότι αυτό που φοβάται η ευρωπαϊκή και η ελληνική ελίτ δεν είναι τόσο τα στελέχη του ΣΥΡΙΖΑ, αλλά το κίνημα το οποίο βρίσκεται από κάτω και το οποίο τον ανέδειξε. Και όχι μόνο αυτό, αλλά φοβάται και, και το κατά πόσον οι λαοί της Ευρώπης θα σκεφτούν ότι υπάρχει και μια άλλη λύση εκτός από αυτήν που τους επέβαλαν. Και το ονομάζουν κίνδυνο δεσμένης χαφάρ στα ολλανδικά.
Okay. So the European leaders and the elites do not really afraid of Syriza. What they're really afraid of is the people that support Syriza right now, which are getting more and more power, and they are also afraid that other European population would realize that actually there is another way from the program imposed and proposed by the European Union and the Troika. And they're afraid that this way of thinking would affect other European countries too.
Αυτό που εμείς πιστεύουμε ότι ο ελληνικός λαός έχει ανάγκη είναι αληθινή αλληλεγγύη. Όχι αλληλεγγύη σαν αυτήν που οι Ευρωπαίοι αρχηγοί δίνουν βοήθεια στις τράπεζές τους μέσω της Ελλάδας, αλλά πραγματική λαϊκή αλληλεγγύη.
So what we really need here is solidarity, not in the sense of economic solidarity, of loaning money and supporting with economic means. Rather a real solidarity between European people.
Γιατί εμείς πιστεύουμε ότι ο ευρωπαϊκός και ο ελληνικός λαός δεν είναι υπεύθυνος για την κρίση και δεν χρειάζεται να την πληρώσει. Και ελπίζουμε ότι το ευρωπαϊκό και το ευρωπαϊκό κίνημα θα βοηθήσει τον ελληνικό λαό στα αιτήματά του.
So we believe that neither European nor Greeks are responsible for the debt. They're not obliged to pay for a debt they didn't create. And we hope that the European movement would support Greek people in this demand.
Και αυτή ακριβώς είναι και η πρόκληση η οποία αυτή τη στιγμή βρίσκεται, υπάρχει για το Ολλανδικό κίνημα και για την Ευρωπαϊκή Αριστερά, κατά πόσον θα μπορέσει να υποστηρίξει τον ελληνικό λαό στα αιτήματά του για αποδέσμευση του χρέους, κατά πόσον θα συμφωνήσουν ότι η λιτότητα πρέπει να σταματήσει και στο βορρά και στο νότο, κατά πόσο είναι δυνατές αλλαγές μέσα στο ευρώ και κυρίως ποια θα είναι τα αιτήματα τα οποία θα μπορέσουν να ενώσουν το ευρωπαϊκό και το ελληνικό κίνημα.
So this is a real challenge for the European movement and the left. Would the European left support Greeks' demands? Would they agree that the austerity must stop in all over Europe, north or south? Are such social economic reforms possible within the euro and the euro and the European Union? So would this demand are these demands common in the European movement could be unified under these demands?
Εμείς πιστεύουμε ότι τα αιτήματα που μπορούν να ενώσουν τους βόρειους με τους νότιους λαούς μπορούν να είναι το σταμάτημα της λιτότητας, να, η φορολόγηση του μεγάλου κεφαλαίου και κυρίως αυτό που έχω γράψει εδώ. Να συμφωνήσουμε όλοι ότι οι λαοί της Ευρώπης δεν πρέπει να πληρώσουν την κρίση γιατί δεν είναι δικιά τους. Την κρίση πρέπει να την πληρώσουν αυτοί που τη δημιούργησαν.
So, we believe that this is what should be done in Europe. The European movement has to be unified under these demands to stop the austerity, to tax large capital, and mostly to agree and support that people are not supposed to pay for a crisis they didn't create.
Και πώς θα γίνει αυτό, θα γίνει αν ο κόσμος ξέρει πια την πραγματική του δύναμη. Και ελπίζω ότι σε λίγο καιρό θα μπορούμε να είμαστε πάλι σε μια τέτοια εκδήλωση και να σβήσουμε το τότς και να ξέρουμε ότι ο κόσμος ξέρει πια την πραγματική του δύναμη στην Ευρώπη.
So how can this be done? This can only be done if people know their power. And let's hope that in a future event like that, we can erase the don't from this slide, and we will be able to say that yes, people do know their power. Thank you. Thank you very much. You are next. Salam.
Thank you. I will in short clarify the position of the Dutch Socialist Party regarding the Greece situation and the coming elections. I had the privilege to be a few days in Greece in the middle of 2011. And we had meetings with governmental officials, trade union leaders, and also representatives of the left, among them with Tsipras of Syriza. And after that, we had several occasions the last few years to have extended communication with him. Our parties are part of the same branch in the European Parliament, although we disagree on issues like European unification and more. We are more Eurosceptical than Syriza is. During our visit in 2011, there was an unemployment rate of 20%. Among youth, half of the population without work. Pensions cut of tens of percent. Tax added value had gone from 11 till 23%. And 119,000 small businessmen had closed their shops and offices. Fear, insecurity and anger, much anger and huge protest in front of the parliament with a protesters camp which was impressive. And also everyday life in Athens was really very exciting. We had a chauffeur of the Dutch embassy who didn't want to pick us up from our budget hotel in a popular neighborhood because he was afraid of damage to his car. Our translator advised advised some of the members of our delegation to put off their tie, because that was not a very similar, very popular symbol at the time. And our taxi driver, when we asked him to bring us to the finance ministry, he told us, he asked us, are you part of the IMF delegation? But because in that case, you better walk and I don't accept you as a client. So that was very nice to have that experience as a left politician. Greece at that time was financially broken with a state debt of 329 billion euros of debt. And experts all over the world and also from our party judged that the debt could never be paid and would be really a blockade for any process of recovery or development. We from the our party from in Dutch Parliament from 2010 on pleaded for a debt reduction program for Greece, criticizing the Troika program, and contrary to the right-wing popular scheme in the Netherlands that Greeks were lazy and responsible for the mess they were in, our political leader Emil Roemer expressed, we don't abandon the Greek people. That's a wrong position. Both the current assistance programs throwing billions of euros into the bottomless pit of economic collapse don't help the Greece nor the Dutch. When we analyze the current situation, you see that we were right in analyzing that the crisis would be deeper instead of resolved by the Troika program. So the question rises, are we that smart or are they that stupid? And the answer should be that our interests and the interests of the Dutch and European elite, bank elite, are very different. And that's why our solutions are very different. They didn't take in consideration the democratic processes, and the Greek people paid a very high price for the so-called recovery program they had to accept for the last few years. So, due to the European elite project, nowadays we face in Europe as a kind of dialectical backlash in scientific speech. So it, instead of unifying Europe and instead of creating progress and democracy and development, we see that contradictions between peoples and countries have deepened. And a lack of respect for democracy and the way an artificial Europe has been constructed by an elite has brought us a lot of serious difficulties. As a left, we should fight to overcome those difficulties, but that won't be easy. And a possible victory of Syriza and the threatening process of renegotiation of the debt will destabilize the political and economic situation in Europe. So that brings the question, how to define our position in relation to the Greece elections and the possible destabilizing effects of it. Our answer is quite easy, I think. We take seriously Greece democracy, so if people speak out for a left government and that left government wants to renegotiate the debt in European context, we say that is okay because that's democracy. And of course, the right wing will try to bring us in problems, telling you are going to spend, you are, your party is going to agree with a transfer of billions of euros from Dutch taxpayers to Greece. And of course, that is not a position we are very fond of. But on the other side, as a left party, you should defend democracy and you should work in favor of socio-economic conditions which make it possible for people to live in a normal and decent way. Those principles can't be negotiated, and in that sense, I promise that my party, in case of a Greek victory of the left, which should be very welcome, and in case of confrontation with the European and Dutch political and business elite, we will choose position in favor of the Greece people and Greece democracy. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Hans. So, please, your next.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I want to thank the invitation of ReINFORM to have some contribution to this debate today. It's really great to see many of the friends I met when we took over the squares already in 2011, and to meet again and discuss about politics. Now, the difference, or I see the difference, is that we talk about party politics and taking state power through elections. And I wonder if it would have changed as activists of we have learned. And I leave this question for the public, and maybe we can come back to that later. There were some questions proposed for this talk, but I thought that my best experiences are with social movements, so I will try to give some insights about what a victory of Syriza will mean for social movements in Greece, also in Spain, but in general on European social movements. And I will give some insights about what these elections mean. This week, the leader of Podemos, Pablo Iglesias, record a short message for the Greek people in relation to the elections. And he said, there are two candidates in the Greek elections. One is Angela Merkel, represented by New Democracy and PASOK, and the other one is Tsipras, represented by Syriza. And for him, it's clear that Greeks need a Greek president, because the peoples of South of Europe, we need to recover our sovereignty. Another way to look at elections is to say it's elections between austerity and democracy. We know who are the defenders of austerity. It's the IMF, the European Central Bank, the European Commission, all institutions without any democratic control whatsoever. And we have seen already what are the consequences of those undemocratic measures for the people, which can only be implemented with tear gas, police repression, and fines. Nowadays, social antagonism occurs in martial terms. In the past, the financial special interest that dominates society will give some concessions to those that are oppressed by the current system. Now it's not the case anymore. We live in a moment of constant situational exemption of in social instability, where any protest, any voice that is against what is presented as the only solution is violently repressed. So we have witnessed what are the consequences to really have a different voice than the one coming from the big financial interests that dominate society. In front of austerity, we have democracy. There is no doubt that the squares movements in Spain and Greece have had a strong influence in the race of Syriza and Podemos. We know that these parties have increased their capacity to build a political project thanks to what happened in the squares. In both countries, we have many similarities, not only geographically, or the weather, or the Mediterranean way of life. We have a long history of military rule in the 20th century, and we have many similarities in our position of the European economy. We're a peripheral economy. And the colleague from ReINFORM has showed that very well. I think it's important to recall the Tunisian Mohamed Bouazizi. He set himself on fire in 2010, and he was the one that initiated the Arab Spring. I think we have to recall the Arab Spring because it was the big influence for the movements that then started the squares movement in the south of Europe. We learned from the Tunisians that radical change from below is possible. Then the Egyptians in Tahrir Square show us the importance of the public space to be the headquarters of the resistance. Then the Indignados in Spain develop further this tactic, creating micro-utopias of the new society in all squares all over the country. This was replicated to some extent in Greece, and then Occupy in Sukkoti Park, in Wall Street, and then all over the world. We are coming from there, and we know. And we have to bear in mind the importance of the lessons of these moments. We were really able to change the political debate. But we also learned that social movements have limits. In Spain during the Indignados, we have several demonstrations of 500,000 people in Madrid. Then we have 1 million people with the citizens' tides, the Mareas Ciudadanas. We have 1.5 million people in Madrid with the March of Dignity. What was the response of that? Police repression and violence. This doesn't mean that social movements don't have a role anymore. Nowadays, the practices developed by social movements, such as sharing economies, cooperatives, taking over of factories like Biome in Greece, these are the practices that really constitute a revolutionary practice. We don't have any more winter palaces to take over. And through military terms, there is no way that we are going to this battle. It's clear that to build a different system, it's only through these small and continuous practices developed by social movements. But we have demonstrated that we have won the battles in the streets and the squares. But now we have to win the battle in the institutions. That's clear. And we shouldn't be naive. If we win the elections, we are just taking a small part of the power. The state apparatus is an important source of power. But we know there are other very important sources of power nowadays. This economic power, especially the power of financial capital, there is the power of the media conglomerates, and also is the military power, which in theory now is under state control. But we have seen in the last years how military power has a tendency to support the status quo before any revolutionary practice. Therefore, these elections in Greece definitely open a window of opportunity for social change and for improve the livelihoods of millions of people in Greece, in Spain, and in other countries. I know there is a big debate in social movements in the sense that but Syriza is not radical enough. There are some things that have changed. This has also happened in Podemos. For instance, in the debate of the debt, when Podemos presented his plan that used the word restructuring the debt, immediately all the debt groups raised their voice saying, this is unacceptable, we should just not pay the debt. But not pay the debt is a bit vague concept, and we have to be serious in our demands as well. If we want to not pay a part of the debt, that's fine. Many parts of our debt are definitely illegitimate. But first of all, we have to do an audit of the debt. And thanks of Syriza and Podemos, now the concept of an audit of the debt is not anymore a small marginal demand of socialists and movements. Now it's at the center of the political debate. And we have changed the way politics is made. And if Syriza takes into power, we are going to have very serious discussions at the highest level on the audit of the debt. So that's already a victory. So what are the other advantages of a victory of Syriza? We can expect definitely that the criminalization of social movements that has been massive in Greece are also in Spain will be not as hard as now with a Syriza government. Then we'll have the discussion about to what extent the demands of social movements will be implemented by Syriza. But definitely the massive criminalization or suppression of social movements will change. And that's a very positive thing. So if thinking who are the ones that might benefit from a victory of Syriza, I identify certainly four groups that have many reasons to see in Syriza an ally or in Podemos. First, all austerity, anti-austerity groups that are against this kind of neoliberal imposition of, you name it, destruction of social services, privatization of public companies, destruction of social labor rights. All these forces have certainly ally in Syriza and Podemos. Also, all the groups fighting against fascism and the rise of the extreme right, which are very numerous in many countries, will have definitely an ally in Syriza and Podemos. Also, all those groups protecting civil liberties and rights and that are against the criminalization of social movements have definitely many agenda points in common with Syriza and Podemos. And finally, all the movements in favor of an audit of the debt have also an ally in Syriza and Podemos. However, it's not only about having a political party allied of the movements. Any progressive political party needs the support of social movements to advance the agenda. This is as important as the conservative political parties need the support of the big capital. Without alliances, it's impossible to advance any political agenda. And this comes from the two sides. Syriza has to listen to social movements, and social movements have to support Syriza, but of course from a critical perspective. And anything comes for free. But there is a historical opportunity nowadays to really change the balance of power at the European level, and we cannot miss this opportunity. What we know for sure, and I'm going to end, is that Syriza and Podemos will have important results this year in elections. We don't know if this political support will be enough to advance agendas that are a direct attack to the privileges of many sectors, certain sectors of society. What seems certain is that it will be not possible anymore to do politics in Greece or Spain without taking into account Syriza and Podemos, and therefore the demands of many social movements. It would be really great if an elections would solve our problems, but we know that that is not going to be the case. Any possibility to change the current state of power in our societies depends on us. So that's our main task. We should not let them, Syriza or Podemos, to do their job. We can join the parties we will want, but if we don't, we have many ways to keep the struggle and to support the social change we want to see. So thank you.
Very much so. And with that, I think we should open the floor for questions and for discussion.
I would like to ask Hans von Heijnigen something more about the destabilization. What does it mean, briefly? What could it mean for the Netherlands if Syriza wins? What are the problems of the economic destabilization? Who's going to pay? Are the problems with the banks Can you explain us briefly that? Thank you.
In the recent past, there was a lot of fear that a crisis in Greece could extend crisis in Spain, Portugal, Ireland, Italy, and that the whole process of going down of the euro would be set in motion. Nowadays, the European elite, and I think it's more fear than security, argues that the Greece question is an isolated question. Private bank interests have been safeguarded by the rescue programs of the last few years. So now it's a question of tax money from the different peoples of Europe, which is at stake and which will play a significant role in the discussion. Should Greece get help and should debt restructuring take place, and who is going to pay the price? So I think on the one hand, the financial and economic consequences when the new Greece government expresses that it won't accept the obligations its predecessors took will be fulfilled. So that's one thing. And the other question is the relation between European states and how this game will be played within the European Union. And I'm very afraid that the right wing will mobilize and create a kind of atmosphere that we should limit Greece's aspirations to find a solution at the cost of European tax money payers. So that will generate a complicated political environment. On the other hand, I think it's time that European economic policies should be revised in a fundamental way. So every crisis also gives opportunities and new perspectives. So it's up to us from the left in different countries to take the handkerchief, this possibility and turn it into something positive. But due to political situation in Europe, I would warn to be too optimistic. At the same time, it's time to fight and it's time to win. So let's, in case of a left victory of Greece, we all should be prepared for a fight for another Europe.
Hello, my name is Alex, a member of Syriza. I would like to really much agree with the comrades from Podemos that, in fact, even if you have a left government, even if that happens, if people do not participate in their trade unions, in the social movements, and so on, a left government will only limit itself in a bureaucratic level. Passing laws that even if they are for the good of the workers, if the workers themselves or the students do not demand themselves these to acquire, let's say, the benefits of these laws, then there won't be any change. So this is I really agree that if these governments in Greece or in Spain would work, we need the participation of the people, to be also critical, of course, and to put pressure also above, because the party is merely the mean and not the goal. But I would like to make a question to Zer from SP. Is SP planning to make any, or are they discussing to make an official exposure of how much actually the banking system, the lenders, have gained from this story with lending, let's say, to Greece, because actually taxpayers pay a lot of money from in Germany and in the Netherlands, a lot of money supposedly going to Greece, but the lenders, actually the institutions, are getting really huge interests. Actually Greece has become a colony of debt, and it's a really lucrative business. So if I'm asking, what is ESPER going to expose, let's say, this this matter? Thank you.
Okay. Not only in our party magazines, but also in debates in Parliament, we are explaining that the so-called Greece assistance program is one big fuck up to support European banks, to rescue European banks, and that it has nothing to do with the interest of Greece people or Dutch people. So in that sense, I don't think we are making mistakes. At the same time, we acknowledge that in the public debate in the Netherlands, with a very strong right-wing campaign, and we have seen that at vital moments in recent years, not only in the Netherlands, but also in Germany and other European countries, that a kind of nationalistic approach, tax money from our people to Greece, is a very difficult issue, and that it's hard to tackle. And of course we will do our best and make clear what the real situation is. But I really, I was impressed how easy it was to mobilize nationalistic feelings during the last 5 years when it came to the question of the Greece problem. So I'm not underestimating the right wing in Northern Europe to campaign against Greece. And of course, I'm clear what the responsibility of my party and other left-wing organizations should be.
So I have a question for the exponent of Syriza from Greece. So my first question is, when you show all the possible reforms that are in the program, the first one is, okay, but what if you go to Brussels, you ask for that, and they say no? This is the first question. And the second question is, even if, let's say, the European Union accepts your program of reforms, don't you think that they will be not enough? Because, for example, you speak about centralized reform, like the quantitative easing from the European Central Bank. But we know that the problem of the European economy are basically the asymmetry between the northern country and the southern country. And for example, the different inflation rate that we had before the crisis. And so even if you, let's say, manage somehow to boost, to put some liquidity in the Greek system, then how can you get, let's say, you will face balance of payment problem after a few years, because let's say basically all these the money that you put in the system will be used to buy foreign goods, so we'll end up exactly in the same situation of 2010 in a few years. So then don't you think that the best option for Greece, but I think also for the other Mediterranean countries, is to leave the European Monetary Union, that is not the European Union? They are two separate things, and I doubt that can be any sustainable and decent growth and full employment inside the European Monetary Union, like it has been managed so far.
Can I have the microphone?
Just a clarification: is this a question to a representative of Syriza? Okay, because Nikoletta is not representative of Syriza, but yeah.
Like that.
Okay.
First of all, I think that the difference about the dealing of, let's say, this negotiation. negotiation, I would say. Where, first of all, something that was mentioned at the very beginning, we're talking about an abolishment of a really large part of the debt. If possible, let's say our highest goal would be 2/3 of it. Let's say that lots of institutional actors themselves have said that this debt is not sustainable anymore. It cannot be paid by any means possible. But what we actually ask in the negotiation is that instead of lending money in order to repay debts, we are going to ask for something different, for something that happened also in Germany in 1953, which means that we will get money that are going to be invested into development plans, with development plans with the state as a pillar of the economy. And because you cannot ask money from someone who doesn't have anything, let's say, to produce, you have a wretched economy. Even the years of austerity have brought the production to its knees. So I think these are going to be really viable arguments when we will be sitting in the same table with the European partners to see how this can be resolved. I don't know if.
No, I think it's not sufficient to cancel. I think it's not sufficient to even cancel debt completely. Because then I'm not sure how, as I said, how can you boost your competitivity, for example. Because, I mean, I don't know, for example, in Italy, we were asked about this structural reform to boost our competitivity. There was basically compression of the wages. Because, in Europe you have a deflationary bias, so if the northern country compress their wages, you are forced to do so as well. But there is no room to compress wages in southern Europe. So how can you solve this problem? In my opinion, the southern country should leave the euro.
I don't think that the currency is the issue, and the problem is that you said about compatibility, let's say, to have to make lower wages. But lowering the wages, even in the small economy, let's say, that doesn't work. The people don't have any money in order to spend and everything. So I think that with a government that will start to increase the basic salaries, to give more rights to the workers, to feel more secure in their workplaces, that is going to actually reignite the very fundamentals of the economy, and not just, let's say, for the big corporations and have cheap hands and Latin Americanize, let's say, the Greek workforce.
Gentlemen, let's bring others into the discussion.
Thank you very much, Alex, for replying.
Now, the big political question. First of all, we should recognize that this discussion is possible and realistic because we are in the situation that we are now, and because actually the people and the movements have raised, even through this incomplete way, through the elections, the question of power. But we should really question what power is. And then the discussion about the European Union and the European project as a whole, I think touches the core of the question. Because if I try to mingle myself in this debate now, raising the wages is not allowed in the European Union. Because it's not only the fiscal rules within the European Union, but a bunch of agreements like the Europact and the Sixth Pact, they are so vague and so interpretable at the will of the European Commission, which is not elected, of course, but the real power lies there, and the real power of the elites is there, just forbids that. And then every country that will take such a step faces the danger of getting a fine. So it's a big political question, and not a fiscal question of whether Syriza or Podemos or
or just a random left or progressive government in a European country will get enough funds. No, that's not the question. And then the real question is whether you can build something different. You can gain power within all this European system and all these structures that exist at the European level and affect every country, and whether the monetary system that has built the Eurozone allows for a different economic policy. And then the big problem of the Eurozone is not, of course, the existing differences between North and South. It is the big redistribution of wealth between the rich and the poor, between labor and capital, to put things in real terms. And the thing is that there is actually no, in this Europe, in this European project, there is no room for a different policy. There is no room, not for just some small changes, but for a big change, for a changing of power. If we really want that, there is no room for that. And this we should bring into the discussion. And the discussion is real, yeah? Or even for Greece. It's not the Greek crisis, it's a European crisis. But if a Syriza government is elected, then it will face, on the 1st of March, a possible stop of liquidity from the European Central Bank. It will face a possible no in any kind of debt renegotiation, and any kind of, and this is not a theoretical question, this is a real question. If you continue servicing the debt, you just don't have money for anything, for any wage increase, for any tax cut, for nothing. So it's a political question of what the new government will do, but then, because, I mean, my group ReINFORM does not represent Syriza, it's not any party, but the question is what the movement will do. And then this we should, the question is not only, okay, what are we going to vote in the elections, what should be the response of the movement in the coming period? And we should build a different way, and we should challenge power, whether Syriza wants it or not, whether Podemos wants it or not, whether the other parties of the left want it or not. And this is what we should do.
Does anyone from the panel wants to address any of these issues?
No, we take any more questions or comments.
My question would be, of course, I know you are not magicians, you cannot predict the future, etc., and you need advice for that here. But my question is also, what will happen if Syriza goes to scenario B and the renegotiations fail and decides to exit the Eurozone? I would like to know beforehand some basic elements of how the everyday life of Greek people in Greece would be, because we are abroad. We take, at least me, I take salary in euros, so it's easy to have an opinion about the exit of the Eurozone or not. And I will have actually a higher value of my salary in Greece. So I want a very serious answer. What do you think will happen concerning short-term and long-term developments? I believe that long-term, a state, of course, will increase its sovereignty and will be capable of doing social policy, as Dimitris mentioned just now. But in short term, they will have great problems with trade, especially with imported goods, and with people moving abroad, of course, to work or study, etc. So I would like your opinion from Podemos and from Spain. I know from Syriza, I think I know, yeah, their opinion. So I would like your opinion on that matter. What do you think? A poor country would react, like not for the Netherlands, because for the Netherlands to go back to their own currency is a bit different story.
Yes,
I will try to answer. It's not an easy question, definitely. I could touch that, and also the question of power, which it's great that Dimitris put it forward, because it's indeed a question of power, and also in terms of leaving the euro or not the euro, I mean, not at the end, it's a matter of how you take decisions based on your sovereignty. I mean, we have to be clear that the struggle is at the beginning still. I mean, we are in a systemic crisis, and there are all kinds of studies, documentaries, showing the relations between the environmental crisis, the crisis of the capitalist system, the end of the dominance of the Western world, and so on and so forth. And this is what is happening in Europe is also a consequence of all this crisis. We should not forget that. There's a, it has been explained, so we'll not go forward to that, not back to that, but we have the current stage of the capitalist system, the financial dominance of the system, the crisis of the financial system, the role of the European banks in this global financial system, the crisis of this system, all the most weak economies within the Eurozone were affected by that. And this is a process of decades, and also the European Union has been on decades. So I think the only sincere answer is that we are going to have very hard times for years, no matter what. No matter if Syriza wants or not, they will be hard anyway. The question is, again, it's a matter of being able to take our own decisions. And it's true that in the current conjuncture within the European Union, there is very little space for maneuver, very little, for all the treaties that have been signed in the last years, because there has been a use of the economic crisis in Europe to implement an agenda based in the institutionalization of neoliberal policies. And we have the European semester, the two-pack, the six-pack, the banking union, we are going to the fiscal union. So any democratic government will have very little power in reality. But it still is an important source of power. So if Syriza or Podemos gets the control of the state apparatus, which is a part of the power, as I said before, I believe one of the possibilities is to evidence the contradictions of the system for many people. Because for many, Europe, the European Union, and the euro are actually a very positive thing for their economy. They give security in a globalized world where China and India and the US are competing, and so on and so forth. So there is all this discourse about why we need to be together in Europe and why the European Union is the solution to that. And to break this consensus in many countries, especially in the North European countries, which are the ones who benefit the most from the euro, especially Germany, Netherlands, Austria, who hold a lot of the political power of the Eurozone. If a progressive government in Syriza, in Greece or Spain, they get took into power and they demand and they propose, like, look, we have 3 million people without access to healthcare in Greece, and we think we have to renationalize certain health services. I give an example. It could be we want to create a public banking system, which is a proposal from Podemos, for these reasons, and you show why it would be beneficial for the economy. And if the only response of the European institutions is to say no, then they evidence what's their position, especially regarding the defense of human rights. This happened with the anti-evictions campaign in Spain. They collected 1.5 million signatures. There was 80% popular support to change the evictions law in Spain. There was a matter of defense of human rights. They were able to go to the Congress, talk with the Congress people and with the financial institutions, and they say no, we are not going to accept your demand, even though you have enormous popular support. At that moment, it became clear that first, Parliament doesn't represent the will of the people, and second, that the financial sector are the ones really having the power. What did the evictions campaign at that moment? They started the scratches, the practice of going to the houses of the politicians to point out to them, you are the responsible to evict families. You are the responsible to create poverty. 80% of the population approved those practices, which would be seen radical for many 1 year before. But why was not radical anymore? Because it became evident what the parliament and the financial institutions are protecting. So I think that progressive governments in Syriza and Greece, Spain, or other countries who give coherent proposals backed by the population that question the way the European Union is functioning, at least will have the effect to evidence to the extent of undemocratic control of the European Union and the extent of the power of financial institutions. So in that sense, I think it's very positive. And I think it's there where we will be able to undermine the current power structures of as Dimitris says, no? This hegemonic thinking, which at the end is what make possible politics. So I come back to a specific question. What's going to happen in Greece is going to be hard for sure. That's the only real answer. I also in Spain and you know,
Europe. Yeah, I agree that, I mean, from a structural level, hard times are going to come. Within the current financial system and the big space there is for speculators, there is no alternative to rescue the euro but austerity policies, which are harming the peoples, not only in the south but also in the north. So there will be a clash and there will be crisis. Regarding the Greece situation, it would be speculation to say something. I mean, you should be really in the center of the political events in Greece to say something which matters. I mean, I don't even have an idea how hard Syriza will play this game. But let's not talk about possible consequences, but I mean, independent how the Greece situation will develop in the coming months, crisis will come and struggle will be there. If not in Greece, it will be Spain or it will be Italy. But I mean, the whole situation that has been constructed around the euro will not be able to be solved without a high price. Not only in financial and economic sense, but also in human and social sense.
Hello. What I would like to give an explanation about is what are the stakes now, both for the European elite and for the Greek state. And I think it wasn't made clear up to now. There are two chances that Greece will play, let's say, taking the optimistic scenario, and Syriza will play it hardly, and we go to the euro, to the European Union, to negotiate for a cut of the debt. And let's say that there's also the popular support in Greece for this option. And at this point, what the European elite has to decide is there may come some calculations, and they will say, we have two chances, that we cut part of the debt, that will probably mean that this is not only for Greece, but also for other countries that are over-debted in the whole world. But let's talk about the European Union. And there's the other chance that they will say, okay, we don't care about this, let them go, let them get out of the euro. There are two chances that the last 100 years, there hasn't been any monetary union that when one party left this monetary union, this union continue to exist, which probably means that if Greece leaves the euro, there's no euro for anybody. And that could probably, and there are already made some studies about this from several institutions, research institutions in Europe, that say that the cost of the change in the currency in the whole Europe will be much greater than cutting the debt, not only of Greece, but also from Spain or from other countries that are really overdebted. And that's the real question that the European elite has to answer. It's a lose-lose situation, probably, unless, of course, I took the optimistic side that Syriza is going to try to negotiate, because we're not absolutely sure about this. But But if this happens, then the European elite has to choose in which way we lose less. At least that's my.
Hi. I want to do, I want to make two comments. First of all, I'm also a member of ReINFORM, and I want to clear that we don't represent any party, and in general, there are many political opinions inside ReINFORM, but we are there to discuss them all together. So my first comment is that the program of Syriza is a social democratic program. It's not radical, and it will function within capitalism itself, so we have to be sure about this. So there is a fear in general from leftists and anarchists in Greece that Syriza will probably win, but not all people are sure that they will really change the situation. Of course there will be some changes, but there is a fear that the main financial and economical tendencies and laws will be close to the same, but they will have a more leftist face mask. So they will say we're doing it a little bit different. So there is a fear about this from people who probably will support Syriza. And I wanted to mention that I believe that the Syriza went so high because of the movement that preceded it. And for example, imagine that in the documentary that we just saw before, I don't know how many of you were here, imagine that the people there were struggling and some of them were victorious without having a party helping them. And Syriza right now probably will help their struggles, but we have to be sure that they will not stop struggling and instead of this go and wait for Syriza to save them. They have to continue, they have to keep struggling. The movement, the social movement, the anti-capitalist movement has to continue and must not stop in order to wait for a leader to come and save them. This will be a step back if this happens. And the second comment I want to make is about the right-wing parties in Europe that was mentioned. I think that the main argument against them should be that they are against, they say that they are against European Union, but instead of this they want a national capitalism. So they want the same situation for their economic elite. They are not the capitalists, and this should be clear. And we have, every day, we have to struggle and convince people that the profits of people in whole Europe, of workers in whole Europe, are the same. So they have the same things to gain. Maybe the wages are different in Netherlands and Greece, but they have to struggle together against their own economic elite and against of other countries. And in this picture, we have to take into account immigrants also, because we haven't talked about them. Immigrants don't even vote. And imagine that a lot of Dutch people and German people are saying that Greeks are to blame, and Greek people, unfortunately, there are some Greek people who say immigrants are to blame, immigrants in Greece. So immigrants in whole Europe, also in Greece, everywhere, are the first who feel this economic crisis, because they are either killed in the borders or really highly exploited in the countries, also Greece. So we have to keep in mind that a worker in Netherlands, a worker in Greece, and an immigrant who will not vote at all should struggle together against them. Thank you.
I have a question in relation to Manos' first comment. I was surprised to see in the slide of the program of Syriza a reactivation of the economy. And I wonder, not only to Syriza, but all the left parties of Europe, what is the reactivation of the economy? If we are going to reactivate the capitalist economy that we have been living with, then what's the change? What are we going to be saying when the recovery takes place? The same that Merkel is saying. We're going to say growth is going up, the rates of any economical parameter is going well, that's fine. No, that's not change for what we want. What we want is the welfare of the people, and just making some makeup of socialist initiatives won't change anything. What we need is to change the system itself. And I wonder if it's on the table, if it's under discussion in Europe level or in each party, proposals of different economy systems. Of course, supporting small initiatives like sharing economy initiatives or collectives is a good idea, but is it a realistic proposal to change the whole economy of the country, or is it just a marginal thing that is nice to see but is not really applicable in the country?
Is this question then?
Yeah. And I know the position of Podemos a bit more, so I would like to hear the Dutch on the picture.
Okay.
Within our party, we are discussing how to democratize economy, and the honest answer is we have more questions than answers. I mean, we should start to recognize that the left, not only in the Netherlands but in Europe, has a far more weaker position than 40 years ago, and even in our factories and even in our offices and even on universities, question of democratization is, there isn't hardly anything to do. And of course you can blame the political elite and the trade union top who is not interested in the stuff. But I mean, conditions on a basic level are very are not very positive, and we should start that discussion. But we have a long road to run. And if we talk about the current situation of unemployment, we should not limit ourselves in preaching socialism, but also within the existing system, look for possibilities to strengthen the position of people. And I mean, even here in Amsterdam, there are 10,000 of youth unemployed, which you don't help with preaching socialism. Of course, that's one thing you have to do, but also look for possibilities within the existing system. And I think our position, at least my party's position, is we are a party who should serve ordinary people in in finding solutions, and in that sense, creating jobs in Greece or in the Netherlands. I don't see that as a wrong perspective because it's within the framework of capitalism. So fighting for ordinary daily interests and a longer term perspective should be combined instead of limiting ourselves in preaching revolution, which does not bring the answer the coming months.
Do you want to reply to that, Alex? No? Yes.
Really shortly, I would say, for example, that Hugo Chavez in Venezuela, he did not do all these changes overnight in order to proceed to the point where Venezuela is at the moment, and it still has a great heritage, which is still developing. So, in my opinion, it is the social movements and the movements of people and the working people, as it's really important that they are cooperating together, they are bringing, they're deciding for themselves, and they're doing all this. But only, let's say, small islands of socialism is not enough. It has to go a little bit more central in order to really achieve, let's say, some more extent, something into a bigger extent. But as this process will go on, then further decentralization of power will come and so on. But at this point, in this context, I think we should take one step at a time.
Thank you. I have a question.
First of all, I'd just like to offer you my coat. Would you like to borrow my coat? You look cold.
No, but there are blankets there.
My name's Dan, I'm from Canada, so I don't really have a huge vested interest in this argument, but I'm still kind of curious because I'm dating a lovely Greek girl, so that's why I'm here. So one of the slides had a big list of all the things Syriza plans to do, and to be honest, going over most of it looked really good, including the rather ambiguous restart the economy, which was left nice and vague. I'm curious about that one. But the one I want to ask about is the renegotiate the debt statement. The problem with that is that there is a financial relationship between Greece and the rest of the European states. And it's being stated in such a way of a sort of unilateral, we are going to renegotiate this agreement with all of these other organizations and governments. What does Greece have to renegotiate with? Like, what do they say, we want a reduction, or we want to pay less, or we want to change the interest rate, or else X? What is that X? And if that X is, well, we'll withdraw from the EU, what are the expectations in that Greece is financially and socially so integrated with the rest of Europe? How would that even go about happening? And specifically for the Dutch representative in the panel, the fact that Europe has become so integrated over the years, the next natural step is some form of a financial union, either the understanding of taxation across various borders or a central integrated banking system of some kind. What's the Dutch position? What's the state of Dutch politics and social ideas around such further financial integration?
So, where do you address the first question?
I don't know. Whoever speaks with Syriza.
No.
I thought it was the woman at the front, but apparently it's not.
No,
so.
It's not. It's a guest we have, and we're very happy.
I don't want to monopolize this discussion, and I think it's more important that we centralize, let's say, the discussion of the power of the social movement of the movements for the actual social change.
Well, you're not obliged to reply to questions anyway. But about your second question, Hans, do you want to reply?
the European Union, the last 20 years, has turned into a project of the European elites, the neoliberal European elite. And there have been several occasions where people could speak out. We have seen the referendum in 2005 in France and in the Netherlands, and an overwhelming majority was against the European Constitution. But nevertheless, people's vote have been annulled, and the elite went on working on integration issues without having the support of the peoples in Europe. And the opposition against the introduction of the euro and related to several steps, important steps which have been made, did not have the result of bringing the European elite towards a position of making creating a kind of pause and rethinking what should be done. And now we're in the midst of a crisis, and economies and currencies have been unified without clear a clear idea how to solve this issue. And in the case of Greece, of having a state debt of 180% of GDP, which really is blocking any perspective of developing the economy, the debt should be restructured. And the big question is, who should pay the price? And what we have seen the last 5 years is that private debts have been converted in public debts. So tell me how we are going to find a solution which could have a support base of people in Europe. That's almost impossible. So the European elite has created a situation where nationalism and national interests are getting a far high profile, and the one who has the solution here, please come over and take the mic.
Yeah,
of course, people's revolution, I agree, but I mean, for the meantime.
Okay, this would be the last. Are there any other hands?
Yeah.
There. Great, okay. So we'll have this last four or five hands. And then we will have responses or final remarks, and I think we can conclude like that. Thank you. But first, let me give the microphone to those that haven't taken it yet.
Hi. So it will be a bit messy. Just some thoughts I had. Basically, I'm trying to respond to the latter actually suggestion. So if you have any idea of what the solution could be, right? So at least I know what can't go on happening. At least this is something that I feel right and I find right. So recently, I don't exactly know what treaties exactly created the situation, but I know at least in Greece, I know that this is a similar picture in Italy, in Spain. I'm not aware of what has happened in the Netherlands. I would like to hear something about it. We have suffered from a great deindustrialization, and we have really we have been funded, but to only, for example, grow two particular actually sectors of our economy, and this is tourism and agriculture. There have been fundings from the European Union so that we would, for example, really destroy some type of crops so that we can really you know, grow something different. And this is basically, in my opinion, what the Greek people and the Greek authorities has let it happen. Actually, they have let it happen, so that because this was in favor maybe of an international form of labor where we would compete in worse, in my opinion, conditions. For example, some years ago, maybe we wouldn't have to import cars from Germany. In particular case, the model actually of the German way of growing recently, not only because of the way that they have funded us, but for example, they have been exporting cars to us that we have, for example, closed our car industry from the 70s. For example, we have, I will speak about some examples like the electricity at the moment. It used to be under at least public majority, so owned. But at the moment, like a big part of the electricity, I think it's telecommunications, I'm sorry, OTE, they're trying to have it under German private control. So is this not a surplus of the German economy? How is this a deficit in the Greek economy? I mean, what does it have to do with the cost of the electricity or of the telecommunication that we pay? My point here is that there is a need that we change the model of doing things. I believe that in order to regain sovereignty, you should also be able to breed the population, cover some of its needs. And therefore, I think that it's of a central importance of how actually do we design a central production actually. This has to be put on the table in Greece, probably in other countries that have suffered from this, I would say, globalization of the economy. This is one point. My other point is that, I wasn't born in this time, but like, if you really want to give, I think, a battle with the state, with its mechanisms, with the interests, economic ones, maybe people in the army, in the police, if you really want to enforce democracy, like for example, as we can see the example of Allende back in the 70s, he tried to do the same thing, although he really found some really, really strong allies, and we saw a dictatorship actually on the way. I'm not saying that this is going to happen in Greece, I don't know, to be honest, it depends on the movement and if they're going to let that. All I'm saying is that one parameter in the equation is also having, collaborating in a sense, parties that actually are promoting people's interest. I mean, a movement such that, for example, they wouldn't let a situation like of an extreme extreme situation can happen. That is another point. Third of all, this is my opinion. I mean, if you see it like that, this is. I don't believe that the crisis in the early 20th century. I mean, that it was solved by more austerity. I think that you have to print money. I'm not exactly aware of if there is going to be a consensus on that in the EU, and this is a really important subject actually that we should put on the table. One last thing, I think that talking about that model that needs to change in Greece, and the model of production that needs to change in Germany, for example. And you're from Canada, I would like to actually mention only, for example, that we can't, also here in the Netherlands, maybe this is something that interests you as well, we can't be having countries actually that allow tax evasion. I mean, Eldorado Gold, that it was shown in the documentary earlier, the mining company, basically they have a post office here in Amsterdam Zuid. And because here, I mean, the interest, is only 0.5%. But unfortunately, this is allowed by this government. It's also helping this company actually to do what it does in the forests of Greece. I think that we need a change of the model, and this also concerns the peoples of other countries than Greece. And so on.
Thank you.
first of all, I want to comment on two notions that they were brought up during the introductory speech. The first one is democracy. I think that there are some obscure points that the public opinion is not aware of, and of course that's absolutely normal, about whether we have democracy in Greece or not. Greece, since we entered the agreement with the IMF, the European Central Bank, and the European Union, has been in a state of emergency, and this state of emergency continues until now. The parties that were elected, they were elected with a different program. They were elected under different conditions, and then they went on and they acted completely opposite from what they were promised during before the elections. After the Papandreou government, and it was another government which was appointed. We had a central banker as a prime minister, and he was appointed by the European elite to serve as a prime minister that would take, that would sign other austerity measures and would complete the PSI agreement. After the central banker prime minister, we had the opposition, the right-wing opposition, which also had a different stance. It was against the memorandum, it was against the agreements that were signed from the previous government, and when it went into the office, it completely changed and went on to support and continues to support, along with two other parties, the coalition government, to support the austerity measures and the memorandum. And what was the European Union's response on that? Any rational person would think that the Europeans that many times accuse Greek politicians as being corrupted or other things would have a say on that. They didn't do anything. They went on and they offered their support to these corrupted governments, to these governments that they lied to the Greek people. So I think this point raises many questions about how do European elites and how do European leaders think of democracy. And in that context, I think that the whole discussion about whether we can democratize the institutions, whether we can democratize the way that the decisions are being made, I think it's a joke, because the recent experience proves the exact opposite. And as I said before, public opinion may in the Netherlands or in other countries may not be aware of what was going on, but we as Greeks, we are fully aware of that, and we have lived under that state of emergency for the past 5 years. I want to go on to my second, to the second thing that was brought up, which is corruption. The same, as I said before, the same leaders that were prime minister in Greece and were accused of corruption were the same leaders that were signing the memorandums, that were signing the austerity measures. I did some international law, and I know that when a treaty is being concluded between the parties and one of the parties is corrupted or has proven to be corrupted or is proven to be signing a treaty under duress or under threats, then this treaty is void. It's not, it does not apply anymore. So we hear about the Greek corruption, and it's true. Until a point, I think corruption is a universal problem. I don't think that there is an institution or there's a state without corruption, because in that system, of course, but that's another discussion. But what we don't hear is about the European perspective of corruption. What we don't hear is about, for example, the Luxembourg WikiLeaks, about how big corporations along Europe are tax evading and are using
Can't I just mention Luxembourg because it's a big discussion about how it's helping it exists as a state with 1,000 banks, not ATMs, banks, and it's the size of an island, of a Greek island. So I wonder what do European leaders have to say about that. I wonder, for example, what they have to say about the example of the former security, the former secret services head that was appointed to Siemens after he retired from Luxembourg. I wonder what they have to say about the investigation that Siemens, one of the biggest corporations in Europe, is being under for corruption and for having a budget only for bribing officials in order to take contracts. I wonder what they have to say about the Greek telecommunications that are flooded with Siemens products, that our traffic lights, our telephone lines, our electricity is all owned by Siemens. I wonder what they have to say about transparency and about corruption. I know that it's always a better narrative to accuse some southern people about being lazy, about being counterproductive. But I think that people should, public opinion, and I think the point of the conversation really supports that, should be aware of those things. And next time that people from the south are being accused for being this and that, that they can bring up some narratives and help, as Mr. Secretary said, to tackle the arguments from the opposite side. One more thing about the debt. Syriza, it is true that Syriza in previous years it had a different stance on the debt. It claimed that it would abolish the whole debt or the biggest part of the debt, but now we see a change on that. We see that they do not support such a claim anymore, at least not in now that they are we are before the elections. I think that the whole audit and the whole investigation of the debt, it's very crucial because it will lead to one very important thing, in my opinion, and that is transparency. I think that if the Greek debt and the other European debts are going to be audited, investigated, I think that we will see many surprises. And if democracy works, we will see that many ministers, many institutions, many entrepreneurs, many job makers, as they call them, many big corporations have used various ways to take advantage of the of their political power and to gain money in the expense of the people. So I think that auditing the debt really demands a political struggle and a political conflict with the current establishment, and for that reason, I think. For that reason, I think that this will probably mean that the whole institution of European Union will collapse under the pressure of the evidence. So I think it's a very central thing. I don't think that a party can only do that. I think that popular support, not only in Greece, but also in other European countries, must demand to do that. And then, after we see the evidence and after we see the outcome of such an investigation, I think then we can decide whether European Union is truly democratic, whether European Union is truly transparent.
Thank you very much. Very
good point. So, okay, because we have to finish it, we have one, two. Thank you
for being sure.
Hello to everyone. I would like to stress out a more practical issue. this is our, as big citizens, our will, and also our right to vote. You might have heard for these days there was a crowdfunding campaign called Flight for Democracy. And I would like also to talk about that issue, if there are any ideas for something similar in Amsterdam. I mean, is there an initiative for charter flight from Amsterdam to Athens or to Thessaloniki, so we can just go and vote? Instead of paying 170 euros, maybe there will be an offer for tour guides or offices that could be a bit cheaper for us. If there is something, please let us know.
For those that don't know, Greek citizens living abroad are not allowed to vote where they are located. They have to go to Greece. That's the big issue. And if someone has an answer to that, you're welcome.
It would be great.
Okay.
Hey, I'm very curious about how both Podemos and Syriza, and maybe also the left-wing organization parties in the Netherlands, how they envision the role of social movements when they got some power. So Syriza will win quite a lot of votes, quite a lot of seats in parliament. Hopefully get into government also. And then, because it's been said a couple of times, like, the movement and the party do need each other. And I know of examples in Spain of the movement that went into the neighborhoods, etc. And hopefully that gives good mutual feedback. What are the perspectives, and I think mostly from now, like, Syriza's and or the Greek movement's perspective? Actually, I think I'm more interested in the perspective of ReINFORM, of the sort of representative of the Greek alternative movement. How do you think that social movement and the party should work together? How should it keep on working together in order to keep both like sharp and with their eyes on everything that needs to be defended and won?
Okay, we'll collect more questions and comments, and then in the last things we can discuss this. This is actually very exactly on what you just said. I just want to say that Syriza might win the election. For some, is the hope that we have for a change in Europe. Syriza has also received quite some critique from both the right, but also from the left. And for me, apart from the main because there is this kind of issue that we've seen in the past, that you have this government that tries to implement some quite, well, for some radical, for some quite mainstream measures, and then you might have Syriza standing up, trying to do some things, and then you go to Europe, and then you will have just a great no. Then there is also the possibility that we're going to have just a happy or not that happy parenthesis that would lead to even stronger, hardest measures from the coming, the after Syriza or the next coming government anyways. But to me, the greatest fear that I have is related to what you just mentioned. That what we've seen, with some exceptions, like what's happening in Skourtes, or the water movement that we saw in the documentary, to me, the greatest fear is that nowadays I see that people just start believing again to this great leader. That I'm going to vote for Syriza, I'm going to vote for Tsipras, and then Tsipras is going to solve all my problems. And I think that this is one of the most important critical issues that we have to be aware of, that on one hand, Syriza also needs the support from the movement, but the movement should stay alive. Because to me, okay,
for the past years I've been living in the Netherlands, but to me, yeah, we have some great peaks, but the situation during the last 5 years, the movement is tired, or at least that's what I feel. And this month, let's say, I'm going to be waiting outside with the box for your donations, those who haven't support. Yeah, those who haven't supported us, please do, because these kind of discussions relate to the movement.
Yeah, last.
Yes.
Thank you for keeping it short.
Thank you.
Very briefly, first of all, why should we be ruled by Draghi, by the ECB? Nobody elected him. I think we have to make the statement true. We have to believe in our power. We didn't elect Draghi. Why should he take political solutions for us? And second, I would like that left-wing parties, movements, work and unite together. We don't do this. In Italy, we had an electoral group, Lista Tsipras, but we have to work together. The SP also, we have to get together and do it together in Europe. We are not doing this. We are very isolated. The lobby, the elite is united. All over the world is globalized. We are not. We have to do this battle together. All the parties, all the movements. Please start today, not tomorrow. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to ask you to give like some final comments and maybe address also the questions that have been raised during this last round. And I'll start with Wilson.
Okay, thank you for all the comments. We can be discussing for a long time. I think it's important to make clear that the elites that we are talking, the caste or the casta, how we call it in Spain, in English, I'm not sure what it is, they are terrified with what has happened in the last years. Really, many of them are really afraid of what has been the capacity of social movements to organize. Since 2011, certain topics that were completely out of the question, such as the way the economic system works, which apparently was working for everyone, this hegemonic thinking has been seriously undermined. It's amazing to take the Financial Times or the Economist and see that they talk about the 99% and that the problems of inequality and how inequality can trigger social unrest and therefore even destroy the current economic situation. And that has been a big victory in the discourse, in the imagination of society. And the big elites that control the messaging, they have been really afraid of this. Nevertheless, as usually, they have no intention to give up any of their privileges, and their only response have been violence repression, as we have seen. Now, the casta in Spain, the oligarchs in Greece and Spain, they are really terrified with the prospect of an election winning of Syriza or Podemos. Why? And this is related with what the comrade explained, which is really key, the corruption. Corruption is one of the key elements of the current economic system. Without corruption, corrupted schemes within the economic and the political system, the system cannot work. And we can give many examples of that. If we manage to do an audit on the debt, many of these corrupted schemes will be very clear, because we will know who made the debt, to what extent, what has been used and for what. And in many cases, and the comrade explained, many debt can be actually said, this debt is not legal, so we are not going to pay it. Not only that, many of these politicians who sign these contracts will have to be prosecuted for their behaviors. In Spain, we have countless cases of corruption being prosecuted by some brave courts that are all the time being blocked by the current government, because the government in power is the most corrupted political institution in Spanish history, and they are in the government. They are very, very afraid of a change in the power in Spain and the capacity to expose these corrupt schemes. We know that the main tool for social control of the current elites is fear. We see that constantly. They are trying to make us afraid of any change, of any alternative. Fear, in many different ways, is the prospect. And I think we can imagine the level of fear we are going to see in the horrible way we have started the year with the attacks in France to Charlie Hebdo. Maybe you see it's disconnected, but this fear climate is going to be only worsened in the coming months. But many believe that fear is changing sides. The elites are terrified with the prospect of a victory of Syriza and Podemos. And we have to win this battle and make sure that we are not afraid anymore, but the other ones are. And I'm sure they are getting really afraid of what is happening.
A few short comments. Left policy without activism has no perspective. So our party has 160 branches in the Netherlands, and we are promoting self-organization and activism at the grassroots level. And at the same time, also within our party, we fight against parliamentarism, because that's something very deeply rooted in the Dutch political culture. And we are explaining to our chaos that within, from the parliament or from the government, there won't be change until people organize themselves and take the streets and let feel their influence in the factories and universities and other places. Second thing, European unity, very important. We are working together with representatives of left parties within the European Parliament. At the same time, there are very different positions within the left regarding European unity. And I would say precisely those differences demonstrate how the European Union as a project does not have deep roots, because our party is a very Eurosceptical party, but most parties, left parties from the south of Europe, are in favor of more Europe. So it's very hard to work out a common project. And what you can do, and what you should do at least, is organize debates within the left in Europe. How do we make steps forward regarding the necessary unity? But that's really, until now, that's a very complicated issue. And the third thing, the discussion about tax evasion and tax competition. The European elite in this moment and the leadership of the European Union is stressing that also companies should pay taxes in Europe. And that's more a part of their BR than a real thing. Because until now, in the Lisbon agenda, competition between countries to get the lowest level of taxes has been seen as one of the major issues to get European economy developed. So it's really something embarrassing that nowadays the European Commission is telling multinationals should pay taxes and therefore we should unify Europe, while until now they are playing the game of countries stimulating to compete in lower taxes. And the position of the Netherlands, we have a tradition of 500 years of free trade tax evasion and all the bad things you can imagine in the world. Stock exchanges have been originated here in the Netherlands. We are a champion in financial speculation, and that is something which has for our party a high priority in public discussions, and that politics should be revised in parliament and on a governmental level. But we have a long road to run, and all those post offices in the south parts of Amsterdam and other places should be destroyed as soon as possible. Thank you.
Στην ενότητα και στα κοινά αιτήματα των ευρωπαϊκών λαών.
We should expect that the next day of the election, provided that Syriza, provided that Syriza wins the elections, we should expect after that a new attack against the demands of people against.